أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، أحمده جل وعلا على نعمه، وأشكره وأثني عليه، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، حديثنا في هذا اليوم سيكون عن السنن المهجورة. هذا الموضوع يتناوله البعض بذكر بعض السنن المهجورة، ولكننا نحتاج قبل ذكر هذه السنن وتطبيقاتها تأصيل لموضوع السنن المهجورة. لا يوجد أحد كتب في تأصيل هذا الموضوع، وإنما جميع من كتب يكتب نماذج من السنن المهجورة، ولذلك من المناسب أن نؤصل لهذا الموضوع بتأصيل لا بذكر فروع وتطبيقات. أولاً، اسم هذا العلم يسميه بعضهم السنن المهجورة، وبعضهم يسميه السنن المندثرة، وبعضهم يسميه السنن المنسية، وبعضهم يسميه السنن المتروكة. والمراد بالسنن المهجورة أمر ثابت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قل من يفعله، قل من يفعله. وهذا الاسم أو هذا الموضوع السنن المهجورة من المهم البحث فيه لعدد من الأمور. أولاً، السعي في إحياء هذه السنن، وقد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من سن في الإسلام سنة فله أجرها وأجر من عمل بها إلى يوم القيامة. والمراد بهذا من سن في الإسلام سنة حسنة، يعني أحيا سنة قد اندثرت بين الناس. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: يبعث الله على رأس كل 100 سنة من يجدد لهذه الأمة دينها. من تجديد الدين إحياء السنن المندثرة. الأمر الثالث أن هناك من يدخل في السنن المهجورة ما ليس منها، إما لكون الإسناد غير صحيح، أو لكون ذلك العمل من الأمور المنسوخة، أو لغير ذلك من الأسباب التي ستأتي. ومن ثم لابد من البحث في تأصيل موضوع السنن المهجورة من أجل نفي الممارسات والبدع المخالفة للشرع التي يدعى إليها باسم أنها من السنن المهجورة. هجر السنن لا يمكن أن يوجد في جميع الأمة، بل لا بد في كل زمان من طائفة تقوم بأداء السنن، ولا يتصور أن يغفل جميع من في الأرض سنة واردة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وذلك لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا تزال طائفة من أمتي على الحق لا يضرهم من خذلهم إلى قيام الساعة. ولذلك فإن هجر السنن أمر نسبي يختلف ما بين بلد وبلد آخر، قد تكون السنة مهجورة في بلد لكنها معمول بها في بلد آخر، ولا يوجد سنة مهجورة في جميع بقاع الأرض. ما حكم هجر السنة؟ وقبل هذا، ما معنى السنة؟ المراد بالسنة ما ورد عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من الأقوال والأفعال والتقريرات. والسنة منها ما هو واجب ومنها ما هو مندوب، ولذلك قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: فعليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي، تمسكوا بها وعضوا عليها بالنواجذ. لا يريد بلفظ السنة هنا المستحبات، بل يريد به كل ما ورد عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. فحينئذ من السنن على هذا الاصطلاح ما هو واجب فيجب العمل به ويحرم هجره، ومن السنن ما يكون مستحبا فيرغب الناس في أدائه، ولكن قد يجب هذا المستحب من السنن المهجورة في بعض الأحوال، منها ما إذا ظن الناس أن هذه السنة من الأمور المحرمة، فيجب على أهل العلم فعل هذه السنن وإحياؤها من أجل نفي هذا المفهوم الذي يوجد عند الناس. كذلك إذا كان الناس يقتدون بشخص ويقتدون ويسيرون على طريقته بحيث إذا لم يوجد لم تفعل السنة المستحبة وجبت عليه، ولذلك إذا اجتمعت صلاة الجمعة مع صلاة العيد في يوم واحد فإن من صلى العيد لا تجب عليه الجمعة إلا الإمام، فإنه وإن صلى العيد يجب عليه أن يصلي الجمعة، الناس يقتدون به. وهكذا قد يقترن بالسنن المهجورة قرائن تجعلها من الواجبات، وقد يكون على أهل الفضل الذين يقتدى بهم في الخير من تأكد هذا الأمر ما ليس منه. السنن المهجورة منها، أو ما يدخله الناس في السنن المهجورة، منها ما هو محل اتفاق بين العلماء، يتفقون على سنيته وعلى أنه أمر مشروع، ومنه ما يقع الاختلاف فيه، فيرى بعض الناس أنه من السنن ويرى آخرون أنه ليس منها. من الأمور التي ينبغي أن تلاحظ أن بعض الناس يبحث عن الأشياء الجديدة والغريبة على الناس ويفعلها أمام الخلق باسم أنه يريد إحياء السنة المهجورة، ولا يكون الأمر كذلك، ويكون ذلك الفعل ليس من السنن. ومن ثم فغرابة هذه الأفعال الجديدة قد تكون سببا من أسباب الخطأ في هذا الباب. كذلك يحاول بعض الناس أن يتتبع الغرائب في الأحاديث فيقع في خطأ، بحيث يقول هذا العمل من السنن المهجورة ويكون هذا الفعل أو هذه السنة إنما وردت بإسناد معلول فيه علة لم يثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن كان ظاهر الإسناد هو الصحة، لكن عندما يأتي أهل الاختصاص في الحديث يجدون أن ذلك الفعل لم يثبت، فيه علة خفية لا يعرفها إلا خاصة الناس. هكذا هناك أمور منسوخة تكون مشروعة في أول الإسلام ثم بعد ذلك ينسخ حكمها، فيأتي بعض الناس من طلبة العلم أو من غيرهم فيدعو إلى ذلك الفعل باسم أنه سنة مهجورة ويكون منسوخا. من أمثلة ذلك العتيرة، ورد في الحديث أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: على أهل كل بيت أضحية وعتيرة. والعتيرة ذبيحة تذبح في شهر رجب، كانوا في أول الإسلام يفعلونها، لكن في آخر الإسلام نهي عنها، نهى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عنها، فقال: لا فرع ولا عتيرة، كما روى ذلك البخاري في صحيحه. فيأتي بعض الناس ويقول: من السنن المهجورة ذبيحة رجب، ولا يكون الأمر كذلك. لماذا؟ لأنها لم تثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. من الأمور التي تلاحظ أيضا أن بعض السنن تكون مشروطة بشرط، بحيث إذا تخلف ذلك الشرط فإنه لا يستحب هذا الفعل. وفيأتي بعض الناس ويريد أن يفعلها في حال عدم وجود ذلك الشرط، فيقع في مخالفة لسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. مثال ذلك: من السنن جلسة الاستراحة، يستحب للإنسان أن يجلس بعد الركعة الأولى والثالثة قبل أن يقوم للثانية والرابعة، لكن هذا مشروط بألا يكون الإنسان مع إمام، إنه إذا كان مع إمام لم يستحب له أن يجلس، لأنه مأمور بالاقتداء بالإمام، كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إنما جعل الإمام ليؤتم به. فحينئذ إذا كان الإمام لا يجلس للاستراحة لم يشرع لمن خلفه أن يجلس للاستراحة. فقد يقول بعض الناس: هذه سنة مهجورة. نقول: لا، هذه سنة مشروطة، وبالتالي لا يشرع لنا أن نفعلها إلا عند وجود ذلك الشرط. كذلك من أنواع الخطأ في هذا الباب أن بعض الناس يجد أفعالاً كان يفعلها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على جهة الجبلة أو العادة، فيظنها من السنن المهجورة. مثال ذلك: يقول قائل بأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حج على بعيره، فيقول: من السنن المهجورة الحج على الإبل. فنقول: هذا خطأ، النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يركب على الجمل في حجته لذات الجمل، وإنما أراد فعل ما هو أيسر له، بالتالي هذا ليس من السنة، وإنما هو من الأفعال العادية. وقد يقع في بعض الأفعال خلاف، هل هو من السنن العادية، هل هو من الأفعال العادية أو من السنن. مثال ذلك: في لبس العمامة، في لبس الخاتم، في كونه يجلس في المحصب ليلة الرابع عشر بعد الحج، في كونه يدخل من باب السلام أو من كدى أو كدي أو يخرج منها، كونه يبيت بذي طوى، فحينئذ لابد من التمحيص في هذا الباب. كذلك يلاحظ أن بعض السنن ترد بأنواع مختلفة، مثال ذلك مثلا في دعاء الاستفتاح ورد بصيغ مختلفة، فيستحب للإنسان أن يقول بهذه الصيغ وينوع بينها، لكن في الأذان ورد هناك أذان بلال وأذان أبي محذورة وإقامتهما، وكلاهما فعل الأذان والإقامة بين يدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. فيأتينا إنسان ويقول من السنن المهجورة أن نؤذن بأذان أبي محذورة، فيقول بعض الأوقات سأؤذن بأذان أبي محذورة، نقول لا، أخطأت، أبو محذورة لم ينوع في أذانه وبلال لم ينوع في أذانه، وبالتالي ليس هذا من السنن المهجورة، وإلا لقيل بأن بلالا رضي الله عنه قد ترك سنة. فإذا استمر الإنسان على شيء يستمر عليه من صيغ الأذان. كذلك لا بد عند إحياء هذه السنن المهجورة من النظر إلى عواقب الأمور فيها. مثال ذلك جاءنا إنسان وقال أنا سأصلي بقراءة ورش والناس لا يعرفون هذه القراءة، أو بقراءة ابن كثير أو بغيرها من قراءات القراء والناس لا يعرفون هذه القراءة، فبعد السلام قاموا وضربوه في المسجد. لماذا؟ قالوا تحرف كتاب الله، تصلي بنا بغير القرآن. حينئذ لا بد لاحظت عاقبة الأمر، قبل أن يصلي ينبههم إذا أراد أن يقرأ بالقراءة الأخرى لئلا يوقع عليهم إشكالا. ولم يكن من شأن علمائنا الأوائل من عهد الصحابة والتابعين أنهم ينوعون في قراءة الصلاة بين أنواع القراءات، يلتزم كل واحد منهم قراءة يسير عليها. ومن هنا فإن من المناسب أن يلاحظ المرء عند رغبة في إحياء السنن المهجورة ما يؤول إليه الأمر، فيأخذ للأمر أهبته ويستعد. ولهذا جاء في الحديث أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لعائشة لولا أن قومك حديث عهد بإسلام لهدمت الكعبة وبنيتها على قواعد إبراهيم، فترك ما يريد فعله مع أنه من القرب ملاحظة للآثار التي ستكون على هذا الفعل. وكما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لولا أني أخشى أن يتحدث الناس أن محمدا قتل أصحابه، يعني لقتلت أهل النفاق. كذلك لا بد أن يلاحظ ما يتعلق بالخوف من تكذيب الشرع، فمرات يأتي الإنسان بسنة يريد من الناس أن يحيوها فيكذب، ويكذب شرع الله ودينه، ويكون من أسباب رد الناس للحق. وقد ورد في الأثر حدث الناس بما يعرفون، أتريدون أن يكذب الله ورسوله؟ وهكذا أيضا لا بد من ملاحظة أن الشرع يتطلع إلى تآلف الناس وعدم اختلافهم، فلا تحيا السنة المهجورة بطريقة تؤدي إلى اختلاف الناس. ولذلك ترك الصحابة صلاة القصر في ميناء من أجل أن عثمان رضي الله عنه كان يتم الصلاة، قال قائلهم الخلاف شر. هكذا لا بد من مراعاة الخواطر بما يؤدي إلى إحياء هذه السنة. لا يلزم أن يكون طالب العلم هو الذي دعا الناس إليها. لو جاء إلى إمام المسجد وجلس معه وسأله هذا الفعل هل هو سنة أو ليس بسنة؟ هل فعله النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أو لم يفعل؟ كيف أفعله وأنا أريد أن أقتدي به صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ فحينئذ أنت جعلت الإمام هو الذي يحيي السنة، ومن ثم يقتدي به بقية الجماعة. لا تسعى إلى أن ينسب إليك إحياء هذه السنة، وإنما سعى وإنما ليكن سعيك إلى أن تحصل أجر إحياء السنة ولو لم تنسب إليك، لأنك تريد ما عند رب العزة والجلال. كذلك لا بد من ملاحظة المقارنة أو الموازنة بين الأفعال عند التعارض. مرات يترك بعض الدعاة وأهل الخير شيئا من الواجبات من أجل الإتيان بسنة مهجورة مستحبة، فنقول انتبه، الواجب أولى ومقدم على المستحبات، ولو كانت المستحبات من الأمور المهجورة. هكذا أيضا لا بد أن نراعي عواقب الأمور فيما يتعلق بالدول وأنظمتها وتشريعاتها. انتبه، حاول أن تجعل هذه الدول هي التي تتبنى إحياء هذه السنة المهجورة أو تأذن فيها. يعني في بعض البلدان تكون الدولة مسلمة، ولكن عندهم علماء قد يخالفون السنة أو يتركون بعض السنن، وبالتالي من المناسب أن تراعي عواقب الأمور بأن تستأذن منهم أو تجعلهم هم الذين يتبنون إحياء هذه السنة. كذلك من الأمور التي ينبغي أن تلاحظ في هذا الباب أن نمهد للسنن المهجورة قبل أن نجعلها بين الناس، إما بوجود المناقشة فيها أو بدعوة بعض الناس إليها على الانفراد قبل أن يدعى العموم، أو بقراءة الأحاديث الواردة فيها في خطبة الجمعة أو في غيرها. والتمهيد للأحكام الشرعية من الأمور المقررة. انظر إلى تحريم الخمر، مهد له بتمهيدات. انظر إلى تحويل القبلة من بيت المقدس إلى الكعبة، مهد له بتمهيدات يتأملها الذي يقرأ في الجزء الأول من سورة البقرة. كذلك لابد عند إحياء السنن المهجورة من أن يكون عند الإنسان حكمة وتأني واختيار للوقت المناسب. لا يعني هذا أن يتخاذل الإنسان عن إحيائها، لكن يختار أفضل الأوقات للدعوة إليها لعله يكون من أسباب انقياد الناس لها. هناك عدد من الأسباب تجعل بعض الناس يهجر السنن. من تلك الأسباب الأخذ بالآراء والتصورات التي تكون عند الإنسان مجردة من الأدلة، وبالتالي يترك ما ورد عن الله وعن رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم لهذه الآراء. كذلك من أسباب هجر السنن عدم وجود من يدعو إلى هذه السنة ويطبقها بحيث يقتدى به فيها. كذلك من أسباب وجود السنن المهجورة الجهل بالسنة. إذا جهل الناس بالسنة سيهجرونها. كذلك من أسباب هجر السنن اشتغال الناس بما لا ينفعهم من الأعمال والأقوال. يشتغلون بالأقوال عن طلب العلم، ويشتغلون بأعمال لعب ولهو وزيارة فلان والحديث فيما جرى وما سيجري والتحليلات السياسية والرياضية، ثم بعد ذلك تنشغل أوقاتهم بما لا يعود عليهم بالنفع دنيا وآخرة. وحينئذ ينبغي أن نتدارس بعض الأسباب المؤدية إلى إحياء السنن المندثرة، ومن ذلك تعلم السنة والسيرة النبوية وقراءة كتب السنة وتداول هذه الكتب وتعريف الناس بها، هذا مما يؤدي إلى ترك السنن المهجورة. هكذا من الأسباب المؤدية إلى إحياء السنن المهجورة وجود الدعاة الذين يدعون لها ويقتدى بهم فيها. ومن أسباب إحياء السنن المهجورة تدارس هذه السنن وتطبيقها أمام الناس بتطبيق عملي. ومن فضل الله عز وجل أن أهل الإيمان يسعون إلى إحياء هذه السنن، لأن في إحياء هذه السنة محبة الله جل وعلا. إذا أحييت سنة مهجورة أحبك الله، كما قال تعالى: قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم. كذلك في أداء هذه السنن المستحبة جبر النقص الذي يحصل على الإنسان في الفرائض، وكذلك الأجر العظيم في السنن النوافل، لأنه يؤدي إلى اقتداء الآخرين بك فيكون لك مثل أجورهم. وهكذا من ثمرات إحياء السنن المهجورة ترك البدع وتعظيم شرع رب العزة والجلال. وسأورد 10 نماذج من السنن المهجورة التي أدعوكم إلى إعادتها. إلا في ترجمة Translate after 10 minutes. طيب نشوف 10 سنن مهجورة. السنة الأولى الاستياك عند دخول المنزل. هل أحد منكم إذا دخل المنزل يستاك؟ تقول: سئلت عائشة رضي الله عنها بما كان يبدأ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عند دخوله المنزل؟ قالت: بالسواك. السنة الثانية قضاء السنن الرواتب. إذا فاتت السنة الراتبة فإنه يشرع لك أن تقضيها. الناس كثير من الناس يغفل عن هذا. وهكذا من أداء السنن الرواتب في البيوت، سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أداؤها في البيوت. المثال الثالث سجود الشكر. عندما يأتي خبر سار يشرع للناس أن يسجدوا سجود الشكر. من السنن المهجورة رفع الصوت بالذكر بعد الصلاة، ورفع الصوت بالتكبير في موسم العيدين. هذا من السنن المهجورة. كذلك من السنن المهجورة تعويذ الأولاد: أعيذكما بكلمات الله التامة من كل شيطان وهامة. هذا من السنن المهجورة. كذلك من السنن المهجورة صلاة النافلة على الراحلة في السفر. إذا ركبت في القطار في سفرك فصلي النافلة. كذلك من السنن المهجورة التبكير للصلوات، ومنها صلاة الجمعة. تلقى قبل الجمعة ما يجون إلا قبل بساعة ولا ساعتين. هكذا من السنن المهجورة صلاة الليل وقراءة العشر الآيات من آخر سورة آل عمران في آخر الليل عند الاستيقاظ لها. كذلك من السنن المهجورة أن ندعو إلى إصلاح القلوب. ندعو إلى إصلاح القلوب لتتعلق بعلام الغيوب سبحانه وتعالى. من السنن المهجورة التكبير عند الصعود. أنت في سفر إذا صعدت فكبر، والتسبيح عند المنخفضات كما ورد عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. هذا عرض موجز وفيه تأصيل لموضوع السنن المهجورة، ولعل فضيلة الشيخ يتفضل بترجمة هذه المعاني التي ذكرتها. وفقكم الله لخيري الدنيا والآخرة، وأسعدكم الله في دنياكم وعند لقائكم لربكم جل وعلا. اللهم يا حي يا قيوم، اجعل عبادك هؤلاء ممن يحيي السنن المهجورة، اللهم اجعل لهم أجر من تبعهم فيها، اللهم اجعلهم ممن يقتدى بهم في الخير ويسار على طريقتهم في الهدى. هذا والله أعلم، وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه، وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين.
بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، ما بعد. As you've seen, we've just drifted slightly in this particular session from the norm, which is that the Shaykh speaks for a little while and then it's translated and the Shaykh speaks again. But the Shaykh has an udhr, he has to go away, so inshallah I'm going to try inshallah and translate whatever he said to the best of my ability. So to proceed, first of all, the Shaykh, may Allah bless him and protect him, he praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sent salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then he began to speak about the subject, which is as-sunan al-mahjura. And this literally translated means those sunan which are abandoned, those practices from the time of the Prophet which are abandoned. And he said that many people who've spoken about this particular subject, when they've spoken about this subject, they didn't make something which is called ta'seel. They didn't define this subject and build upon it, but rather what most of them did was just mention a number of sunan that were abandoned. So they didn't actually make it an ilmi bahth as such, they just mentioned examples of sunan which are abandoned. So the Shaykh said that he wants to try and establish a grounding, a foundation in the subject. So he first of all started by telling us the names which are given to this particular subject. So the first, as we've already heard, as-sunan al-mahjura, those abandoned sunan. He said also mentioned as-sunan al-mansiya, those sunan which are forgotten. Or as-sunan al-matruka, those sunan which are left. So there are a number of names that are given, all of them mean the same thing. Those sunan which are abandoned. And also, he said, we also have to define what we mean by the word sunan, because the word sunnah itself can have many meanings if it is just generalized like this. So he specified that here we mean by the sunnah here the Prophet's actions, his statements, what he allowed to happen in front of him. This is what he means by the sunan, and not like sunnah as opposed to bid'ah. Then the Shaykh went on to mention that there are some very important things that we should mention when it comes to reviving those sunan. This is something which Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised and recommended for us, that we should revive those sorts of sunan which are lost. And from amongst the statements which are mentioned about from the Prophet about this subject is the statement of the Prophet, whoever does in Islam a sunnah hasana, a good sunnah. What is meant by whoever does in Islam a good sunnah? It doesn't mean that he brings something which is invented from himself, because the wording of the Prophet is a sunnah in Islam, meaning it's already in Islam. So that means it's something which already has its foundations in Islam. So the interpretation the Shaykh said of this hadith is that whoever revives a sunnah which is from Islam and it's become forgotten, or it is something which has become, it is something which the majority of the people don't know about. Maybe a few people know about it. So this is the first thing that the Shaykh mentioned, that Allah's Messenger gave us an asal or something, a principle in this matter of reviving the sunnah. And also the statement of the Prophet concerning a mujaddid that would come at the end of every 100 years. That's all about somebody who's going to revive the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third point that the Shaykh mentioned is that sometimes we have people who want or are eager to revive something and they consider it to be a sunnah which is mahjur, it's something which is abandoned. They consider it to be something which is a sunnah which is abandoned, but they're mistaken, they have a misconception. And what's that misconception? Maybe it's based on the fact that they're not well versed in the knowledge of hadith. So for them, they were not able to realize that this, in this particular narration, the chain of narration has a defect, an illah. And this illah is something which the vast majority of people wouldn't be able to differentiate. Only those ulama who are so well grounded in this knowledge would identify it. So maybe by accident, people will try and revive something which they believe is a sunnah which is abandoned, but in actual fact, it's not even thabit, it's not even established. Or sometimes we find that people are trying to make tahsil of something or revive a sunnah, but it actually it's not a sunnah, it's a bidah. So they're reviving something which is not a sunnah, but actually it's a bidah. So the Shaykh mentioned this, that also in this tahsil that he's making, that we are careful that we don't associate something to the sunnah which is not from the sunnah and say this is a sunnah which is abandoned. Also the Shaykh told us something else which is very important. Whilst we say a sunnah mahjura or a sunnah which is abandoned, we don't think for one minute that it's something which is lost completely. What we mean by that is that perhaps in a particular country this is not known, or in a particular area this is not known. But rest assured that somewhere in the world, tulab al-ilm and ulama know it and they are practicing it. So it's not something which is completely lost to the ummah, but rather it's something which is lost to some people, but others will know it. As the Prophet said, there will always remain a group of the people on the truth. So what does that mean? That these sunnahs will be protected and saved by those people upon this truth, upon this haqq, until the Qiyamah, until the Day of Judgment. So the Shaykh said that this is Amrun Nisbi, and this is something which is specific maybe to a group of people or to a particular country, that this thing may be, this sunnah may be missing, but in other places they will be flourishing and established. Also, when the Shaykh was speaking concerning the resurrecting or rejuvenating the sunnah which are forgotten, that Allah's Messenger, when he talks about, when we talk about the Prophet's sunnah, we're talking about his statements and his actions. And his statements and his actions, they fall into two categories. That which is wajib, incumbent upon us, we can't leave it. And that which is mustahab or mandub ilayhi, that which is recommended. So either it's wajib, we can't leave it, or either it's mandub, it is something which is recommended for us. So this is something that we must understand. And also don't forget that the Prophet ﷺ, when he, in the hadith of Irbad ibn Sariya, when the Prophet ﷺ gave an admonition to the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, he was admonishing them, and they were moved by this wa'ad that the Prophet ﷺ gave them. And at the end of that, they said, O Messenger of Allah, give us some advice. What did he advise them? He said, Alaykum bi sunnati wa sunnati al-khulafa al-rashidin al-mahdin min ba'di. So upon you to take my sunnah, hold on to my sunnah, and the sunnah of the rightly guided khalifas after me, وَعَضُّ عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِذِ, and hold on to them with your molar teeth. So the sunnah al-mahjura, one thing we have to understand is that the sunnah al-mahjura, even in establishing them or trying to revive them, there are certain principles that we should follow. And when we are following these principles, the Shaykh mentioned a number of them, and this talk is, mashallah, I'm impressed by the way he's presented it. He's defined how we should be careful in not creating problems when we are trying to revive something which is maybe not known to the people. So he's given us many principles we should follow to try and do that in the correct way. And also to not fall into the pitfalls of creating problems or reviving something which is actually not for the Sunan al-Mahjura. So the Shaykh went on to mention that those people who are reviving the Sunan, they have to look at the situation that they're in around them. It's not just that we try and just, once we've learned something, that we go and try and establish it, but we look at the situation which is around us, and is it the correct time to do those things? Sometimes what happens is, the people, as we mentioned before, that the people try and establish something which they believe it is from the Sunnah al-Mahjura, and it's not. It's not from those things which is from the Sunnah. It's not established. And that might be because of some misconception that they have. Also, one of the things that we should also bear in mind is, well, who are the sort of people who should be establishing these sort of Sunnah? Those people who are followed. Those people that people have generally accepted them, that these are people of knowledge, that these are the people who we can go back to as a reference point. As the Shaykh said, رجل يقتضى به, person who is followed. So those are the people who it's incumbent upon them that they should, you know, rise to this and try and revive the Sunan. And then the Shaykh gives us some examples. For example, Salat al-Eid. In the Salat al-Eid, this is, Salat al-Jum'ah, the Prophet gave us these opportunities to educate people. So the Imam should take this opportunity before he actually goes about trying to revive this, that he speaks to the people and educates them about it, reading to them the hadith which are on this subject, so they are familiar with this subject. So he's already laid for this revival a foundation. So taking opportunities like the Jummah and the Khutbat al-Eid, taking these opportunities first of all to illuminate people about this subject. Also, one of the things that the Shaykh mentioned is that when it comes to the Sunan, that the sort of people who are the ones who should be foremost in identifying them and then promoting them to the people are the people who are the people of Fadl, the people of merit, scholars and Tulab al-Ilm. They're the people who are going to be followed. So they're the people who should be the foremost in reviving this. And then there's more chance that this will be accepted because it's coming from those people who are there for reference points for people. Then the Shaykh went on to mention that there are Sunan al-Mahjura. Some of them are Mahal ittifaq. Some things are agreed upon and some things there might be a difference of opinion upon in concerning these Sunan. Because some people, what do? Some people go about and all they want to do is try and find something new so that they can be identified. And he said, this is one of the mistakes. So he says that it would be better for a person if he were to learn something and he found it to be a Sunnah al-Mahjura, that he were to go to the local Imam of the Masjid and that he were to speak to him and advise him concerning it. And then maybe he would be the right person to revive that Sunnah. Because he said, it's not a point of making brownie points for ourselves to say that I'm the one who revived it. Because maybe you will go about and make a mess of it, but the Imam, who is somebody who is respected and accepted in that society, if he were the person to revive it, then it would be something which would be easily accepted. Also, I think one of the things that the Shaykh mentioned, that we have to be careful in establishing what is a Sunnah al-Mahjura. Sometimes something is passed off as a Sunnah al-Mahjura or an abandoned Sunnah, and actually it's not, because maybe it's not established with an authentic chain. Or maybe it is something which is abrogated. See, sometimes what happens is some Tulab al-Ilm, they come across something, but they don't have the sight and the insight to be able to really identify. So maybe they promote something when in actual fact might be abrogated. Also, the Shaykh mentioned that examples of this, that something which is not established, for example, the Shaykh gave us an example earlier, and I'm going to mention this example again, is the dhabiha on the day of Eid. The dhabiha is something which is established, but there is a narration which talks about another dhabiha which is done in the month of Ramadan, Atiyah. And this sunnah was something which the Prophet used to order the companions to do. But then later on it was something which was made mansukh, or it was abrogated. So as a result of that being abrogated, it's no longer something which is a sunnah. So if somebody comes along to us today and says, oh, what about the dhabih of the month of Rajab? Why don't we do that? That's a sunnah which is mahjura. He would be wrong. Because in actual fact, this is something which is not a sunnah which has been abandoned, but rather this is a sunnah which has been abrogated. So this is also one of the things that a person should bear in mind when he is looking to revive something, that it's not something which is abrogated, or it is something which was from the shara before, and Allah's Messenger later then told us not to do it. And also he said that there are some sunan which are known as sunan mashruta, that there is a condition to those sunan. It is a sunnah, yes, and maybe it might even be mahjur, but it is something which has a condition attached to it. And then the Shaykh gave us an excellent example. He said the example of jalsatul istiraha, when a person sits after doing the sajda. And the Shaykh mentioned that this is something which has a shart to it. What is the shart? That you're not with the imam. If you're with the imam, then you do what the imam is doing. You don't do this jalsa. If the imam gets up, you get up with him. Because the Prophet said that imam has been placed to be the leader for you, that you follow him. So in this case, you wouldn't do this because it's the shart that you are with the imam now, so you do what the imam is doing. Also, there are some things that there are some difference of opinion on, which are af'al al-ada. Some people said that these were af'al al-ada, or these were something which were out of habit, habitual things that some people might consider to be sunnah al-mahjura. Like Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he did hajj on a camel. Would we now, if somebody came to us and said to us that the sunnah of the Prophet in hajj is to go on a camel, would we say, no, we have to go on a camel because this is the sunnah and it's abandoned sunnah? No, this is something which at that time that was the mode of transport, and now the mode of transport is changed. So we wouldn't say that this is a sunnah mahjura. This is from adat, or just from habit, or things which were used at the time. And as the Shaykh mentioned, also some of these adat might be, there might be some difference of opinion. The Shaykh gave us two examples. People say sunnah al-mahjura is the imama, or the ring that the Prophet used to wear. And he said that some of the scholars have differed and said this is from sunnah al-jibiliyah. This is the habit of the Prophet, but not necessarily something which is a sunnah which is mahjura. As the Shaykh mentioned before, that this is mahal ikhtilaf, or there is some difference on this particular matter. Or also the Shaykh gave us another example of the Prophet when he used to come to Mecca, when he used to perform hajj, that he would spend a night in a place called Mukhassab, and then he would go the following day and enter from a particular door. And he said also this is again something which is could be also interpreted as a sunnah al-mahjura. Also it could be interpreted as something which is ada. So the Shaykh, what was he trying to impress upon us? A tamhis. That a person mistahqiq, that he makes sure that what he is trying to revive is actually a sunnah. For example, the Shaykh gives us another example of something which might be mistaken as a sunnah which is mahjura, the adhan of Bilal and the adhan of Abi Mahdura. Somebody might say, well, the adhan of Bilal, everybody's doing, why have we abandoned the adhan of Abi Mahdura? So the Shaykh here, this is not considered one of the sunnah al-mahdura, and so you wouldn't be expected, or we wouldn't call people to do this particular sunnah. And another example the Shaykh also mentioned is that this is, when you try and establish a sunnah which is mahjura, one of the things that we should do is also pay attention to what is going to be the effect of that when we do it in our society around us. And the Shaykh gives us an excellent example here of a person, perhaps he comes to a masjid, or he is in a masjid where all of the people are used to a particular qira'ah. You know, there are many qira'at, so there's a particular qira'ah that the people are known to recite in that country or in that masjid. So somebody comes along and then recites with a qira'ah that people are not familiar with. So what will happen? This will create fitna. While he might be in himself have a good intention that he's trying to revive this sunnah, but what is he actually doing? He's going to cause people maybe even to belie this qira'ah and say, you've tried to change the Quran, and this is tahrif of the Quran, and it would cause a fitna. So this is something which a person should always look at, that what he's going to do, what will be the impact of what he's going to do? Or as the Shaykh said, that if he was going to do that, and he knew that the people were not familiar with that, that he should inform them before he does that, so that the people will know. as Allah's Messenger is to tell us that we should speak to the people at their level. And the Prophet warned us that, would you like that Allah and His Messenger should be belied? Because of a statement we say, which the people didn't understand, they might say, this is a lie. And as a result of that, they will be belying Allah and His Messenger. So as a result of that, a person should look at the situation which is around him before he goes ahead and does something like this. And you find that, in fact, the ulama of qira'at, they used to always recite the qira'at which were familiar to the people in that area, as opposed to coming with the qira'at which was new, that the people were not familiar with. And this is something which we say, it goes back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you look at the statement of the Prophet, what he said to our mother Aisha radiallahu anha wa an abiha, when he was saying about dismantling the Kaaba, and he was saying that if your people were not new in the religion, if they had not just recently come to Islam, then I would have dismantled the Kaaba and then built it back upon its original foundations, upon which Ibrahim alayhi salam built it. So look at the Prophet here, he's looking at things with wisdom. What will be the effect and the impact of the people? Or as the Prophet said, that if it were not for the fact that that the people might say that Muhammad is killing his own companions and people who've entered his religion, I would have killed the people of nifaq, people of hypocrisy. And the Prophet knew them because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed him concerning them. But he didn't do that because of the impact that that would have on the society. As we mentioned before, the other point was that khawf min takdhib al-shara, fear that people might say that the sharia, or belie the sharia, because we didn't introduce this thing at the right time to the right people. There are many things that need to be taken into consideration. One of those things that the Shaykh mentioned is that you look at the khawatir of the people, how the people will feel towards that. So as he said, for example, if a talib al-ilm, if he wants to revive a sunnah, it would be good for him to go and sit with the imam, somebody who is accepted. And that if he were to explain to him, this is what he wants to do, and prove to him with adilla, and then the imam were the one who were to revive this would be better. And it would be easier for the people and lighter for the people to accept. So these are some of the things that the Shaykh mentioned. Also, one of the things that the people fall into mistake, the Shaykh mentioned, is a person might be trying to revive something which is mustahab or recommended, but at the expense of that, he may leave something which is wajib. And he said, this is a mistake as well, and a mistake which people fall into. So when we're trying to revive something, we should be looking at not leaving something which is wajib or which is incumbent upon us. Also, one of the things is looking at countries and how those countries run. For example, you might find that a particular country has a specific way of doing something. So you come along now and you want to revive something which is the sunnah, and that country or that particular place has a specific way of doing something, it will be looked down upon and frowned upon. So a person should also look at these things before they try and establish something which they consider to be a sunnah mahjura, which they're trying to revive. And that in wisdom, in trying to establish that. And then the Shaykh, again, he reminds us about something, about making preparation, the groundwork before trying to revive that sunnah. Which is perhaps, then he gave us examples, perhaps you go with this knowledge that you have and you've established that it is a sunnah which is mahjura, that you go to those people who you think they will accept it and they're students of knowledge, and you call them to it first. Once they accept it, then this leaves open a path now to try and invite more people to this sunnah al-mahjura. And when it becomes more common, the people will accept it. Or also, as the Shaykh mentioned earlier and then repeated again, reading these ahadith in Jummah, the Jummah Salah, before the Jummah Salah, the khutbah. So in the khutbah, he reads out these ahadith referring to this particular subject, this particular sunnah, so that the people are familiar that there are ahadith which are established on this particular issue. And then the Shaykh gives us examples. How many examples we see of this? Of the Qibla, for example. How the Qibla was changed. And there are many, many examples that the Shaykh gave, and other examples that the Shaykh left out. So even this changing of the qibla was something, there was a prelude before it, there was an introduction before that, which made the people take this thing and accept it easily. It made it easier for the people to accept. And this is what the Shaykh said concerning hikmah, that the hikmah is for a person to look at the correct time and the correct place to do this. And a person shouldn't think that, oh, people will say that I'm, or some people say that, oh, I'm delaying establishing something which is from the Sunnah. No, maybe there is a wisdom in that, and that wisdom might, inshallah, bring about the acceptance of this, or the easy acceptance of this without causing fitna. Then the Shaykh also mentioned, what are the asbab, what are the means or the reasons behind which people abandon certain sunan? Why were they abandoned? And there were reasons for this. And if you look, sometimes those reasons were because people didn't take texts, but they took just opinions of people. So as a result of that, they left the adilla and they just followed opinions of people. So this could be one reason why these particular sunan were lost, these particular actions of the Prophet were lost. Or it could be that people just didn't have knowledge concerning it. Or it was that people, or there weren't people who would call to this. So there weren't du'at that were calling to the sunan, which were mahjura. Or it was perhaps because people busied themselves with that which wasn't beneficial, and so they didn't come across the sunan and promote them and give dawah to them, to the people. Then the Shaykh mentioned the asbab by which a person might revive those sunan. So he said, first of all, by educating, reading, teaching, and introducing to the people the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Second thing is the appearance or the existence of du'at in a particular society, that those du'at would call to these things. Also, one of the reasons is when people who know about them stop practicing them. Sometimes what happens is somebody knows about it, but he doesn't practice it. So if he doesn't practice it, it doesn't become known, and as a result of that, it becomes lost. So a person should try and practice what they know, at least once in their lives. It's known by many of the ulama of the past that if they learn something from the sunnah of the Prophet, even if they didn't continue to practice it all the time, they did it at least once in their lives. This is well known by about many of the scholars of the past, and even some of the scholars of our time, like Sheikh Al-Albani, said, I never left a hadith that I was established and authentic in front of me, except that I would do it at least once in my life. So this is one of the other reasons, is that when people stop practicing those sunan in front of the people, so the people, it no longer remains familiar to them. When a person revives a sunan, what does that do for the person who revives a sunan? First of all, it causes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to love him. And if this were the only thing that would be achieved, it would be sufficient. That if you revive something from the shara of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and you did that, and all the problems that you had to face because of that, you did that for Allah's sake sincerely, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would love you. The second thing is that you would make up the naqs, the deficiency, and the fara'id which you're doing. For example, you do fara'id, but you have some deficiency in them. By doing this sunan, you will fill those naqs or those deficiencies by doing this sunan. Also, the ajr, the reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for doing the sunan and reviving the sunan. And also, because it will cause you to leave the bid'ah, and it will cause you to make ta'zeem of the sunnah. So by reviving the sunnah, you will make ta'zeem of the sunnah. And you will cause bid'ah to be left. People will leave the bid'ah. Then the Shaykh gives us 10 examples of sunnah al-mahjura. Those sunnah which have been abandoned or forgotten. So the first one was making siwak when entering one's home. Because our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, when she was asked about the Prophet, that she said that the Prophet used to make siwak before he used to enter his home. So this is the first sunnah. That a person, before they enter their home, they make siwak so their mouth is clean before they enter into their home. And also, the second one is to make qada of the sunnah that you missed, sunnah rawatib. You did some of the sunnah, you usually do them. Then one day, because you were late, you were held up, work, whatever, you ended up missing some of the sunnah which are linked to the fard prayer, maybe four sunnah before the dhuhr prayer. You miss them, normally you pray them. What's become forgotten is that a person should make qada of them. The Prophet used to make qada of them. So this is also one of the sunnah and mahjura, is that a person shouldn't leave making qada of them. He should make qada of them, make them up. Also from the sunnah al-mahjura, sujood al-shukr. Making a sajda for shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when a person receives news which is good. Fourth one is raising one's voice with dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after the salah and in the takbirat of Eid. Fifth one is invoking the du'as and protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon one's children, as the Prophet used to do for his grandsons, Al-Hassan and Hussein radiallahu anhum. Seventh one, making the nafl salawat and the nafl prayers upon one's riding beast, or in this case, if a person is on a bus or an aeroplane or any other mode of transport, a person makes nafl sitting on his transport, because the Prophet used to make nafl upon his camel. So doing the nafl prayers when a person is traveling upon their riding beast or their transport. Seven, to arrive early for the prayers. And then the Shaykh mentioned specifically the Jummah prayer, arriving early, an hour early, an hour and a half early, half an hour early. Nowadays the sunnah has become, try and sort of make it just before the Imam stands on the minbar. But this is not, this is a sunnah which is mahjura. We can identify with this, because you find that people flood in when the Imam is already making the khutbah. But the idea is that we should make tabkir, we should be early and try and arrive for the sunnah, for the Jummah prayer and for the other prayers as well. Also, number eight, Salatul Layl, the night prayer. So standing in the night and making prayer in the night. This is also one of the sunnah, which is mahjura. Also, reciting 10 ayat from Surat Al-Imran in the last part of the night, if a person gets up to recite the last 10 ayat from Surat Al-Imran. And also, the Shaykh mentioned rectifying the hearts and causing them to be connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then also the Shaykh mentioned finally is that when a person is going up, he's ascending, that he makes takbir. So if you're going up the stairs, you say takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And when you're coming down, you say tasbih, subhanallah, subhanallah, subhanallah. And with that the Shaykh concluded and he made a beautiful dua for all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him the same. Jazakum Allah khairan. Subhanakallah.